there's some places on the ice where I just really like catching guys. D-men wheeling around the net is always a dangerous spot because going around the net, sometimes they're fumbling with the puck and I can meet them on the other side. There's just some places that are dangerous when I'm on the ice, so I've got to be aware.
My guest today is a human reckoning, a man who lives to finish checks along the boards, a relentless agitator, elite trash talker.
I'm here to turn the dust, you're so f***ing old.
Kiss blower, but also a man who's evolved as the NHL has, and in so doing, has become one of the league's best and most boisterous stories. It's a joy to welcome, from your Vegas Golden Knights, Mr. Ryan Reaves.
Rog, how you doing?
Ryan, you were born in the great city of Winnipeg. Your dad, Willard, was an all-star running back in the Canadian Football League. Go Blue Bombers. Is it true that as a kid, you were better at football than hockey?
I would say I was maybe a little bit better at football. I was just much bigger than everybody. I get my growth spurt early. My dad taught me at an early age to run through people. I was just running over people until I quit football, basically.
You began to take your hockey more seriously, playing for junior hockey's Brandon Wheat Kings. And as you started to train harder, your mum stepped in to take your game to the next level. Can you tell us what she did? The pork chops.
The pork chops. When my mom would drive down, she would either bring me 3 pork chops with applesauce, and I would eat 2 of them right before warmups and 1 after the first period. I don't know how I'd puke all over the ice one game, but I did that for my full 3-year career in Brandon. Once I got into the AHL, that was just a wrap. There was no more of that. I would have got chirped all day.
Shout out to mom's pork chops, the true breakfast of champions.
Yeah.
You grabbed the attention of the St. Louis Blues in the 2005 draft. You came into the league as an intimidator.
When he goes to the bench, he pulled out one of his teeth.
One hit that stays etched in my cortex. 2017, game 3 of the playoffs against Minnesota. You notice Wild defenseman Nate Prosser with his head down as he challenges for the puck.
I can't exactly remember the hit from Prosser because, I'll be honest, I've caught Prosser a couple times in my career and I've let him know.
Prosser is 6'2". He's a solid unit.
I'm not a small kid either, though. I'm 225 pounds. I got some weight behind these bones. He's a big boy, but he's a little scrawnier than I am. I'm built more like a football player.
When you deliver hits like that, the venue goes wild. At home, delirium.
In Vegas, it's been unbelievable because it got to the point where I was running guys and you could hear the whole crowd chanting Reaves. It fires me up even more, and I love playing in Vegas because of that. On the road, it's even more fun because you either get booed or the fans start screaming or, oh, what's going on? Yeah, I definitely like the ones on the road a little bit more. I think those are a little more fun.
Your chirping game is also an essential club in your golf bag.
What are you going to do?
The players rated you 3rd best in the league.
Should have been 1st, but okay, continue.
There's an art to trash talking. And you once said you consider yourself Picasso. What is the secret to a good chirp?
Making it off the cuff. When you try and remember chirps, it's not as funny.
I love that you make it sound like you write chirps before the game.
Can we swear on here? I don't know. Probably not, hey?
You do whatever you want.
You can beep it out, right? You know you've got under guy's skin when you chirp him and all he says is, oh, f*** you, because he has nothing to say. And that's what I feel like a lot of guys have been saying to me lately.
And on the rare occasion that you run out of words, you just drop a chicken sound or two from the bench.
That is true. Yeah, my sound effects. What's that show that guy used to make all those sound effects? That really old one.
Police Academy.
Police Academy. There you go. I fancy myself a little bit of that guy.
Ryan, you defined yourself as one of the toughest forces in the league at the very time the NHL was changing. The players were getting faster, there was a lot less aggression, the league began to emphasise skill, speed. Was there a moment when you realised, I need to change, I need to adapt to become a different kind of player, one who can keep his gloves on and offer positives to my team?
Players like me that used to only play 4 minutes a night and they'd go out and try and get, you know, 3 fights and couldn't really skate, couldn't turn, and didn't really have an impact on the game. Those guys started kind of leaving the league. And to me, I just got in the league. I didn't want to be a guy that was pushed out because the game was changing. So, you know, where I used to go back home and throw around 400 pounds on the bench press and just try and get big, when I made the NHL, that's what I was doing. I was skating with a beer league and I was working out in the gym. That's it. Well, now I had to get a skating coach and work on my speed and my stride and work on some skill. So it was hard work, but it wasn't a hard decision to put in the work.
Then Blues head coach Ken Hitchcock told the press, "We looked at it from a career standpoint. Ryan had to become quicker, have more endurance to become a good player. He had to address a lot of things, quite frankly. Lesser players, lesser human beings, like me for instance, they're stung by any criticism." But how did it feel emotionally to hear him say that?
It was just the fact of life. I played with players who dominated the WHL. For me to be one of the guys that has made it from all those teams, it's only because I was willing to adapt. For me, I wanted to keep playing as long as I could. I dreamt of this. I didn't want it to end after 3 years. I wanted to keep going as long as my body could possibly do it. And so to do that, I had to adapt. So it wasn't like, oh, I got to do something here. It was, okay, let's get to work and let's stay around.
You started to make the highlights for Showtime passes through traffic. You set up line mates Scotty Upshaw and Carl Brunziak for incredible goals. Yeah. And then you said, I don't know, I must have blacked out when I made that pass.
I blacked out a couple times on the ice. Let me be honest with you. A Showtime pass in the NHL is not what I do. It was a Showtime pass for Ryan Reaves. For me, that was far above what my skill level was. But in the NHL, that was just a regular pass.
You've not just evolved on the ice. You've grown into the role of ambassador and leader off it. After the tragic shooting of Jacob Blake last August, you were in the bubble and you stepped up to play a pivotal role amongst the NHL's players as they frame their approach to this historic moment.
For, you know, all these athletes in here to take a stand and say, you know what, we see the problem too, and we stand behind you. You know, I go to war with these guys and I hate their guts on the ice, but I couldn't be more proud of these guys.
Were you surprised by the offers of help and support from across the league, allies from all points?
I wouldn't say I was surprised. I think I was just unsure of how exactly it was all going to go down. It went from a lot of anxiety for me because, you know, I'm one of very few black players in this league, and I didn't know how it was going to be looked at, how the league was going to react, how people were going to react. And I knew there was going to be backlash. There's always going to be backlash for that. There's going to be good and there's going to be bad. The night before everything happened, I got zero sleep, not even a couple seconds. Once that morning all unfolded, I was really relieved. I was happy to see how much support there was. And I was proud of all those players. They saw a problem going on, something that doesn't necessarily touch them or something that they haven't necessarily seen in their life. But for them to stand up and recognize that problem, I mean, I stood in front of guys that I was trying to kill on ice. And we put all that aside for something bigger than hockey at that time. So it was a powerful moment. I hate them on the ice, but off the ice, I'll grab a beer with any one of them. Most of them.
Ryan, you were a player who came into the league offering a physical style that was then phased out of modern hockey. Instead of being a dinosaur doomed to extinction, you reinvented yourself as a player who could contribute on the ice. The ability to transform is one of the most difficult human traits. Are you occasionally surprised by the extent of your metamorphosis?
No, not really. I think I've had a clear vision of what I wanted to do my whole life. I don't know what grade I was, but a teacher, we were supposed to write about what we wanted to do when we were older. And I said I wanted to be a football or hockey player. And I remember she gave me the paper back and said, "You need to say something more realistic." And I said, "Well, that is realistic. That's what I want to do. Why is that unrealistic?" And I said, "Well, it's hard to do that." "Well, yeah, but it's hard to do anything you really want to do. Anything's hard, but if you want to do it, you got to put the work in."
It is Reaves! That's been a big storyline here in Game 1. Reaves winning battles, getting pucks to the front of the net, going to make skillful plays.